Shabbat Shalom, everyone. Welcome to our service here today at Kol Mashiach. If you want to come in and take your seats. And also, we would like people to come and move up to the front section if you could move. We're trying to reserve the back for folks that need to, that have like young kids or whatever. But if we could kind of move up as people come in. We'd love to have you up here. There's always this like hole right here, but I want to see some smiling faces here too. And also welcome to all of you watching us on the live stream. It's wonderful to have you here joining us at Kol Mashiach Online. We're live streaming on our Facebook page, on our YouTube channel, and on our website, shalombrevard.com. We thank you all for being here. It's truly a blessing to be in the house of the Lord, to take our rest in Him today. Let's go to Him in prayer this morning. Lord, we thank You and praise You. We come before Your throne, and we ask, Lord God, that You would help us to enter into Your rest today. It's so hard, Lord God, when we're going through the motions, going through life. Everything is so fast-paced, and it feels like it's just speeding up all the time. But Lord, help us to just stop for a minute. Shabbat is supposed to be an island in time for us. So let's just take our rest in You today, Lord God. I pray that You would settle our spirits, settle our hearts, and prepare us to hear Your words and what You have to say today. We lift up the service to You, Lord. We thank You for the privilege of coming before You and coming together as a community. Be with us today, and may Your will be done, and may Your glory be shown. In Yeshua's mighty name, amen. Amen. Let's all stand this morning together as we worship Him. Let's greet each other with Shabbat Shalom.
Shalom, everyone. Welcome this morning. We begin this morning with the call to worship, the Baruch Hu. Bless the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed is the Lord, the Blessed One, for all eternity. Baruch Hu et Adonai Hamvarach. Baruch Adonai Hamvarach Leolam Vahed. Blessed, praised, glorified, exalted, and honored be the name of the King of Kings, the Holy One, blessed be He. He is the first and the last, and there is no God beside Him. Extol Him who abides in the heavens, and rejoice before the countenance of Him who is named Lord. His name is exalted far beyond all blessings and psalms. Blessed is the name of His glorious kingdom for all eternity. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time and forever. Please chant the Shema with me as we turn to the east. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Yehechad, Baruch Shem Kivod, Malchutu Leolam Vahed. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Blessed is the name of His glorious kingdom for all eternity. Ve'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha v'chol levavcha u'v'chol nafshecha u'v'chol me'odecha. V'hayu ha-dvarim ha-ele asher anochi mitzavcha hayom al-levavecha v'shinantam levanecha v'dibar tobom v'shiftecho b'vetecha uv'lechtecho v'aderech Ushav b'cha uvkumecha. Ukshar tam liot al yadecha. V'hayu letotafot b'neinecha. Uchtav tam al mizuzot b'techa. Uvisharecha.
And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might, and have these words which I command you this day be upon your heart. And you shall teach them diligently to your children, and speak of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you retire, and when you arise. And you shall bind them for a sign upon your hand, and let them be frontlets between your eyes. And you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates. Ve'ahavta l'reicha kamocha, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Amen. We continue with the Vishamru. The children of Israel shall keep the Shabbat, observing it throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Shabbat to another, all flesh shall come to worship before me, says the Lord.
Shabbat, let Torah come to be to Olam. Bnei Yisrael, Bnei Yisrael, Yeshua. There is no one like 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 Yeshua.
Surround those
In the shadow
Chapter 43, it says this: Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings forth chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Listen, the Lord is a way maker. He is going to make a way. He's going to make paths where there is none. He's going to part waters. He is going to move mountains. We have to just trust that. We have to trust that, and we need to be able to be used by Him so that He can do that, and so the testimony of the Lord can go forth. So, you know, today is a day where we can come and say, you're the way maker, but let's say you're the way maker who's going to make a way in my life and use me to make a way in others' life. So let's go to Him. Lord, we thank You because You make a way where there is no way. We've seen, Lord, the impossible become possible because of You. And Lord, You are the great light of the world, Yeshua. We pray that that light shines in us. We proclaim Your light, we proclaim Your name, and we ask You, Lord, to use us to show people, not us, but You, to show people that You are the way maker. We pray that You would provide opportunities for us to share about You, for us to share about how You've done these things in our lives and You can do it in others, and that You are the great, the mighty God. And You are the one who makes a way where there is no way. We thank You, God. We praise You. We give You the glory. In Yeshua's name, amen and amen.
Lord, open my lips that my mouth may declare Your praise. Blessed are You, Lord our God, and God of our fathers, God of Abraham, God of Isaac, and God of Jacob. The great, mighty, and awesome God, the Most High God, who bestows grace and creates all and remembers the righteousness of the fathers and brings a Redeemer to their children's children for His name's sake with love. O King, Helper, Savior, and Shield, blessed are You, O Lord, Shield of Abraham. Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu, Elohei Avoteinu. Elohei Abraham, Elohei Yitzchak, Elohei Yaakov, Ael Hagadol Hagibor V'Hanora, El Elyon, Gomel Chasadim Tovim, V'chone Hakol, V'zocher Chaste Avot, Umevi Goel Livnei V'neihem, Lema'an Shemo Be'ava. Melech ozeru Mashiach umagen, Baruch atah Adonai, magen Avraham. You, O Lord, are mighty forever. You raise the dead, You are mighty to save. You sustain the living with grace, resurrect the dead with abundant mercy. Uphold the falling, heal the sick, set free those in bondage, and keep faith with those that sleep in the dust. Who is like You, Master of mighty deeds? And who can compare to You, King, who causes death and restores life and makes salvation sprout? And You are faithful to resurrect the dead. Blessed are You, O Lord, who resurrects the dead. Atagi bo leolam Adonai, mechaye metim ata rav lahoshiach. Mechakel chayim bechesed, mechaye meitim berachamim rabim. So mech noflim verofe cholim, umati rasurim. Om kaye emunato lishene yafa, micha mocha bahal givurot. Umido meloch, melech meimit umechaye, umatzmiach Yeshua, v'ne'emanata l'achayod meitim. Baruch atah Adonai, mechaye ha-meitim. You are holy, and your name is holy, and holy ones will proclaim your praise daily. Blessed are you, Lord, the holy God. Ata kadosh, v'shimcha kadosh, ukdokshim b'chol yom yehallelucha sela, baruch ata Adonai, ha'el hakadosh. Bless the Lord, the blessed one. Blessed is the Lord, the blessed one, for all eternity. Baruch hu et Adonai, hambaruch. Baruch Adonai, hambaruch. Le'olam vahed. Now, as we process the Torah, as we say every week, please do not touch it with your hands. Please use your siddur or the tzitzit on your talit. When the ark would travel, Moses would say, "Arise, O Lord, and let your enemies be scattered, and let them that hate you flee from you. For from Zion will go forth the Torah, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Blessed be he who in his holiness gave the Torah to his people, Israel."
Vayahi ben Soharon v'yomeh Moshe, Kuma Adonai ve'afutsu hayvecha, ve'anusu misanecha, mipanecha, ki mitzion teitzehe Torah. Ki mitzion teitzehe Torah, udevar Adonai me Yerushalayim. Baruch shenatan Torah Torah, Baruch shenatan Torah Torah, le'amo Yisrael.
Please read with me responsively.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Echad Eloheinu, Gadol Adonenu, Gadol Shmo. Echad Eloheinu, Gadol Adonenu, Gadol Shmo. Gadlul Adonai iti, Unaram Mashmo Yachtov.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. One is our God, great is our Master, holy is his name. One is our God, great is our Master, holy is his name. Declare the greatness of the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the strength, the splendor, the triumph, and the glory, even everything in heaven and earth. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom and the sovereignty over every leader. Exalt the Lord our God and bow at his feet. He is holy. Exalt the Lord our God and bow to his holy mountain, for holy is the Lord our God.
Yeah.
be seated. Great time of praise and worship today. Great time of just getting the Torah out, processing the Torah. I like to say this every once in a while that, you know, when we take out the scroll and we process it, we are not worshiping the scroll. We're not worshiping any objects. All we're worshiping is the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, who gives us his word. So this is the word of God. You know, I was just reading a commentary, I think it was yesterday, and it was all about how in the past, in ancient times, all of these nations, all these pagan nations, they would have in their, you know, great halls and in their places of worship, all of these statues and idols and all these things you can imagine. And one of them came in and invaded Jerusalem at one point, and he found when he went into the temple was a bunch of scrolls. And he was like, what's going on here? There's no gods here. There's no idols here. All there was the scrolls. All there was the word of God. So we've always been a religion and a people that doesn't worship things but worships the Creator. And that's how it always has been in Judaism. That's how it is in the New Covenant community of all of us together. So it's a blessing to have this scroll here that we can read the very words of God. Before we get to that today, we want to have a special blessing over our kids. As we know, we're going to be dismissing kids, the different classes at different times. But this is a blessing over all the kids, over all the children. So if you're a caregiver, if you're a parent or a guardian, you know, and you got your kids next to you, just if you want to spread your tallit over them, if you want to pray this over them as we're praying, but this is a blessing for them and for their lives. For boys, we say, Yisimcha Elohim ki Ephraim v'chi Menashe. May God make you like Ephraim and Menashe. And for girls, we say, Yisimach Elohim ki Sarah Rivka Rachel v'Lea. May God make you as Sarah, Rivka, Rachel, and Leah. Amen and amen. I'd like to dismiss the 4 to 7s now. 4 to 7-year-olds, you are dismissed to your class. Have a wonderful time. And 8 to 12s, you'll stay in here for a little bit more of the Torah service, and then you'll be dismissed in a little bit.
Yamod Yitzchak ben Yosef la Torah.
Baruch hu et Adonai hamvarach. Baruch Adonai hamvarach le'olam vahed. Baruch ata Adonai hamvarach le'olam vahed. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam. Asher bacha beno mikol ha'amin. V'natan lanu et Torato. Baruch ata Adonai notein ha'torah. Bless the Lord, the Blessed One. Blessed is the Lord, the Blessed One, for all eternity. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen us from all peoples and given us his Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah. Amen. The scroll is unbalanced these days, right? So it's very, very light on this side, so we're just going to keep it stopped up here. We are in Noach, Toldot Noach, or the Torah portion Noach. So our Torah portion today is going to be Genesis 6:9 to 11:32. 6:9 to 11:32. We will read in the Hebrew and English the first three verses. Ele toldot Noach, Noach ish tzadik, tamim haya Badorotav et ha Elohim hitalech Noach veyoled Noach shelasha bamin et shem et cham vaet yafet vatasal chet haaretz lifnei ha Elohim Vatimale haaretz chamas. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his generation. Noah walked with God. And Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, or Ham, and Japheth. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with violence. And now we have our drash today.
So, Shabbat Shalom, everyone. Noach. Noach is the second portion of our Torah readings of the year. And this portion goes from Noah and the flood, and it goes all the way until the Tower of Babel. So it's about a 1,000-year span on there. Now, we know that the Torah is a wonderful set of books, its laws, its history of the Jewish people, and we'll see right after this week's portion, starting with next week, you're introduced to Abraham, and then there are a lot of information about Abraham and then the Jewish people. We see a lot of events in the Torah. We see a lot of instructions that are given of the Torah. However, if we stand back from all of these things, we see the need for Messiah, and we see the story of Messiah. And that is really, in a sense, the primary story, but in a way it's underlying because we're reading all of these things that are going on before the Jewish people, for the formation of the Jewish people, and then eventually we read about the Messiah. So we have to always keep that in mind. The Torah is a wonderful set of books, 5 books, and Messiah is in the Torah from the beginning to the end. And so in the first portion that Bob read last week, we see the first sin, and it was the first sin by individuals, Adam and Eve. But now in the second portion with Noach and the great flood and the Tower of Babel, we see the sin of the entire world. So we see the progression from individuals, now the entire world. So let's look at our first scriptures here this morning. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. So the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping things and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. So we see what has happened to the people of the world in a relatively short time from Adam and Eve until we read about Noah. So portions 1 and 2 show us the need for Messiah. Sin of individuals leading up to sin of the world. And then portion number 2, this week's portion, Noah, shows us the vehicle for salvation. Why? Because we see the great flood, and we read about the ark, and we read about Noah. So, why was there a flood? If God wanted to destroy all of mankind, why did he bring a flood? Why wasn't it a huge explosion that wiped everything out? Why wasn't it a plague that he brought on the world and everyone would slowly die? Or why wouldn't they just die? Everyone's hearts would stop bleeding and they would beating and they would stop breathing, and that would have been the end of mankind. And he could have selectively picked Noah and his family. Why didn't it happen that way? So let's look at Genesis 6:14. God said, make yourself an ark of gopher wood, and make rooms in the ark and cover it with, and inside and outside with pitch. And so this is what I want to key in this morning, our vehicle for salvation. And so pitch, the word pitch is kafer, and it is the three Hebrew letters kaf, fe, and resh. You know, in the Hebrew language, all the root words are three Hebrew letters, and then you get the different words that stem off of the root word. And so we have kafer. Kafer is the root word, basically, for kippur, atone or atonement. And so kapar is to cover sin or atone for sin. So we see that when God said, I want you to cover that ark inside and outside with pitch, he was using basically the same root word for atonement of sin and to cover up sin. Because man needs atonement of sin. If you want a leaky ark, you don't put the pitch on. If you want a leaky ark, you put the pitch on. If you want to get into the book of life, you have to have atonement of sin. And the waters, also we see, the waters, would bring life or they would bring death to them. Let's go to our last. I will sprinkle clean water on you and I will be clean. And you will be clean and I will cleanse you from all your impurities and from all your idols. Yeshua said, truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and spirit. But whoever drinks of the waters that I will give will never thirst, but the waters that I shall give him will become to him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. And through the Kippur, through the atonement, the kaf, the fe, and the resh, we have the living waters, and those are the living waters that give us eternal life for each and every one of us that would accept that wonderful vehicle for atonement. Shabbat Shalom, everyone.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher natan lanu toret v'chei olam nota b'tuchenu. Baruch atah Adonai notein ha-Torah. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us a Torah of truth and has planted eternal life in our midst. Blessed are you, O Lord, giver of the Torah.
Amen. As we put the scrolls away, I ask that everyone please rise for Vezot HaTorah.
Vezot HaTorah Asher San Moshe Lifnei Bnei Yisrael Al Pi Adonai Biad Moshe.
And this is the Torah that Moses placed before the children of Israel at the command of the Lord through Moses' hand. Amen. And when it rested, he would say, return, O Lord, to the myriad thousands of Israel. Arise, O Lord, to your resting place, you in the ark of your might. Let your priests be clothed in righteousness, and your godly ones will sing joyously. For the sake of David your servant, turn not away the face of your anointed, for I have given you a good teaching. Do not forsake my Torah. It is a tree of life to those who take hold of it, and those who support it are praiseworthy. Its ways are of pleasantness, and all of its paths are peace. Bring us back, Lord, to you, and we shall come, renew our days as of old.
It's Kaihi, Lemachazikima, Betom, Chehamusha, Drache. Hush.
Come to our Haftarah portion today. It's from the book of Isaiah, Isaiah 54, 1 to 55, 5. And our reading today will be from Isaiah 54, 1 through 3. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher bachar ben ve'im tovim v'ratza b'divrehem Ha-ne'emarim be'emet, Baruch atah Adonai, Ha-bocher ba-Torah, Uv-Moshe avdo, U-Yisrael amo, Uv-in-vien ha-emet, Va-tzedek. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who selected good prophets and was pleased with their words, which were spoken truthfully. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, who chooses the Torah, your servant Moses, your people Israel, and prophets of truth and righteousness. Isaiah 54, 1 to 3. Sing, O barren one who did not bear. Break forth into singing and cry aloud, you who have not been in labor. For the children of the desolate one will be more than the children of her who is married, says the Lord. Enlarge the place of your tent, and let the curtains of your habitations be stretched out. Do not hold back. Lengthen the cords and strengthen your stakes. For you will spread abroad to the right and to the left, and your offspring will possess the nations and will people the desolate cities. Amen. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam tzor kol haolamim tzadik bechol hadarot Ha'el ha-ne'man, ha-omer ve-yosei, ha-medaber u-mikayim, shel kol devarav emet vatzedech. Ne'man, atahu Adonai Eloheinu, v'ne'emanim devarecha, v'devar echad midvarecha, achor lo yashuv recham, ki el melech ne'man, v'rachamata, Baruch atah Adonai, ha'el ha-ne'eman b'kol devarav. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, Rock of all eternities, faithful in all generations, the trustworthy God, who says and does, who speaks and makes it come to pass, all of whose words are true and righteous. Faithful are you, O Lord our God, and faithful are your words, for not one of yours is turned back unfulfilled. For you are a faithful and compassionate God and King. Blessed are you, O Lord, the God who is faithful in all his words. Amen.
Amen. It is our duty to praise the Master of all, to ascribe greatness to the author of creation, for he made us unlike the nations of the lands and has not placed us like the families of the earth. He has not made our portion like theirs and our lot like all their multitudes. And we bend the knee and bow and acknowledge our thanks before the King over kings, the Holy One, blessed be he. He stretches out heaven and establishes earth's foundation, and the seat of his glory is in the heavens above, and the presence of his power is in the most exalted heights. He is our God, there is none other. True is our King, there is nothing beside him. As it is written in his Torah, and you shall know this day and take to your heart that the Lord, he is God, in the heavens above and on the earth below, there is none other.
Olenu l'shabeach la'adon ha'kol, la'tet ketalah yotzeh breshit, shelo asanu kigoye ha'ratzot, v'lo ho'samanu, Kemish bechod hadamam, shelo sam Elkeinu kahem, v'gohor aleinu kechol hamonan, v'anachnu korim u'mishtachavim u'modim, lifnei melech malchei hamlachim, hakadosh baruch hu. Eshamayim biotzer haaretz, u'moshav yikarov bat shamayim mimahal, u'shkinat uzod, u'shkinat uzod, begafei miromim, hu Eloheinu einod, emet malkeinu efetzulato, Kakatu batorato, Vayadata hayom, Vayadata hayom, Vahashevota helivavecha, Ki Adonai hua Elohim, Vashamayim mimahal, Vial haaretz, Vial haaretz, Mihitochat einod.
And it is said, the Lord shall be king over all the world, and on that day the Lord will be one, and his name one.
V'ne'emar v'haya Adonai le'melech al kol haaretz, Bayom hahu, bayom hahu, yihye Adonai echad. Ushemo echad.
And everyone may be seated.
Let's dismiss our 8 to 12s now. 8 to 12-year-olds, you're dismissed to your Shabbat school class for today, for the rest of the service. We want to take a minute and welcome any first-time visitors that we have here with us in the sanctuary. If it's your first time here at Kol Mashiach, you would have received a visitor packet. If you did not receive a packet, if you could raise your hand and our ushers will get you one. But there's some information in here we want to direct your attention to. The biggest thing is the connection card. If you could fill out this connection card, fill it out, print clearly so we can catch your name and all your contact information. And anytime during or after the service today, if you could put it in the offering box, we'd love to be able to connect with you and hear how you like the service and what you if you had any questions about the service. So welcome to all of our visitors here in person. And also welcome to all of you watching us on the live stream from wherever you're watching. I just love interacting with people, and it's usually throughout the week on email, people in Texas and people in all these places that are finding us and are able to worship with us because there's really nothing around them messianic. So it's a wonderful thing and resource for people to have, for them to tune in and to worship with us even remotely. So welcome to all of you watching us. Now we're going to take a minute to take our tithes and offerings and to receive them today. We have a few ways that you can give to the ministry. The best and easiest and quickest way is shalombrevard.com/donate. You can also give by placing your offering in the offering box here in the sanctuary or sending it in to us at our P.O. box here in Melbourne, Florida. So as we prepare our hearts and as we prepare these offerings for the Lord, let's go to Him in prayer. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father and our King, we thank you because you're a waymaker, you're a faithful God, and you've been so faithful to Kol Mashiach and to all of us over the years. We pray, Lord God, that these offerings would be received and taken and used for your kingdom purposes according to your will. May we be faithful stewards of your money, Lord, in order to further your message that Yeshua is the Messiah. We thank you and we praise you in Yeshua's name. Amen and amen. And now we have some announcements.
Yachad, our grief support group, meets today at 12 p.m. in Classroom 2. This group is for those in our congregation who have lost or are caring for loved ones. Dance classes resume this week with children's dance meeting at 12:30 in the educational wing and congregational dance at 1 p.m. No experience is necessary, and men and women are welcome. Torah for Today, both online and in person, meets at its regular time of 1 o'clock. If you need the password to attend, please email info@shalombrevard.com before the end of the service today. Last week was an exciting start to our new message series. Make sure you've picked up your Matthew reading list from the table in the foyer and downloaded it from our website to follow along with each week's readings. Congregational prayer is this Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Please join us as we come together to petition God for the needs of our congregation, community, and each other. At Kol Mashiach, we are committed to the mitzvah of Lador Vador from generation to generation. As God has commanded, we make teaching our children a priority, passing on the lessons and values of the Bible. If you are a member here, we ask you to prayerfully consider joining our Shabbat school team as a teacher or helper. Your commitment to serve just once a month can impact our children for a lifetime. If you are willing to fill this vital need, please speak to Rabbi or send an email to info@shalombrevard.com.
Let's open up our Bibles this morning to Matthew chapter 2. Now, if you have your reading cards, you know that we're starting the second chapter of Matthew today, and there's just so much in chapter 2 as there is in every chapter. We're going to get through the first 12 verses today in the message. You know, last week we started out with the book, and we saw this remarkable genealogy of Yeshua. He's a descendant of Abraham. He's a descendant of David. We see how he fits the lineage. He's perfectly fits the lineage. We see how he fulfilled the prophecies. We see how he is the rightful Messiah and King. He's all of that. We're going to continue to see that throughout the series. He's the rightful King for Israel, and he's the rightful King for the whole world. He is the Messiah, not just for Israel. It was never the point for it to be only Israel, the nation. It was to go out from Jerusalem, from Judea, to the ends of the earth. Now, we continue to see that throughout the series, as I said, even today. But in this passage today, this is a key point here. We continue to talk about Yeshua fulfilling prophecy, talk about his birth. We're going to get into some things there. But what we have is an interesting contrast today in this passage. And the contrast is with two different groups of people. On one hand, you have the wise men who are called the Magi. We're going to talk about the wise men today. And we see that their heart, their actions, everything that they were doing was for the Lord. But there's two groups of people today. And the other person that we're going to look at is King Herod, of course. And we could all safely say that King Herod was not like the wise men. He wasn't seeking the Lord. He wasn't seeking the ways of the Lord. So you have two different perspectives in the passage. One, with the wise men, they were just that. They were wise. The Bible talks about wisdom, and the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, right? Proverbs chapter 1. But the wise men were wise because they were seeking God. They were looking for the Lord. They were searching. They were moving toward the Lord, focused on the Lord and his ways. Moving toward God. In contrast, we see Herod, and people like Herod in the scripture are not referred to as wise. They're referred to as fools, right? That distinction that we get in Proverbs and other books of the Bible, Herod is what we would put in the category of the fool. Those are the people that they're not moving towards God, they're moving away from God. They're not seeking God, they're seeking themselves. They're not searching for the Lord. They're searching for their own well-being, their own pride, their own self-fulfillment in life. And we see it very clearly in the passage today. Now, God already mentioned all this way back in the Torah so that this is not a surprise as far as these groups of people. And we have a choice to be one of those two groups. In the book of Deuteronomy, later, we read it just a few weeks ago when we got to Deuteronomy, we saw when the children of Israel were ready to enter the land of Israel, there was a choice before them. It was a choice to be wise men and women, people, children, or it was a choice to be foolish. And God called that, another way of saying that is you can choose blessings or curses. blessings or curses, life or death, wisdom or foolishness. The choice is there for you and I today. Are we going to be wise like the Magi, like the wise men, moving toward the Lord, seeking God in all of our ways? Or are we going to be like Herod, moving away from the Lord, seeking himself and his own gratification and his own power? In various ways, we do both, I think, in our lives. We have to focus on being wise like the wise men and not a fool like Herod. So think of that. That's a choice we all have. Think of that today as we go through the passage. So Matthew 2, verse 1. Let's begin with the text. Now after Yeshua was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. Now we're going to be going a little slow today because we've got to dissect a whole lot of stuff in here. I can't go too slow because we'd be here for about 4 or 5 hours and you're going to get hungry and I'm going to hear stomachs growling. So listen, we'll go slow, but we got to get through some things. We won't go too slow, though. Yeshua was born in this place called Beit Lechem. He was born sometime between 4 and 8 BCE. Contrary to popular opinion, Yeshua was not born in zero, right? The year zero. He was born sometime between 4 and 8 BCE. Why do we say he wasn't born in year zero? That whole thing was an error that was done by a monk or a priest centuries after with the calendar. He was born in 4 to 8 BCE. We'll find out because, and I'll mention this later, Herod dies in 4 BCE. He can't be born after Herod dies. It doesn't fit the passage. So the context would be that he died somewhere... he was born somewhere between 4 and 8 BCE. He was born in a town called Beit Lechem, in English, Bethlehem. Beit Lechem is a tiny town about 5 miles from Jerusalem. It was in a region called Judea, or Judah, right? When the 12 tribes got their land, the tribe of Judah in the south got a big swath of land, and in that land there was the city of Jerusalem, of course, and there was a town called Beit Lechem, 5 miles outside of Jerusalem. Now, why is this all important for Matthew in his gospel to put all these details in? Well, everything has an importance. If God puts something in the Bible, there's a reason. There's something we need to take notice of. Turn with me down to Matthew 2, 3 through 6. We get a little bit more idea of what's going on with why does Matthew say Beit Lechem. Verse 3, when Herod the king heard this, he heard that the child was born in Beit Lechem, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. He assembled, and assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. And they told him, in Bethlehem, in Judea, for so is written by the prophet, and you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Now listen, that is a quote from a scripture that we're going to read in just a second. Go to the book of Micah, chapter 5, verse 2. Herod was king at the time in Judea. He ruled over that whole region, Jerusalem, Beit Lechem, that whole region. Herod assembled the chief priests and scribes. They were situated in Jerusalem. Those were the Jewish leadership that were in the temple, ministering, administering the sacrifices, writing the scrolls of the Torah. These were the most influential, the most studied, the most educated of Israel. So he assembled all of the right people and said, according to those scrolls you're writing, according to that, all your life, how it's going, according to the Torah and the prophets, where is the Messiah supposed to be born? And what do they say? They say it's in the book of Micah, and it's in book of Micah 5:2. But you, O Bethlehem Ephratath, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from old, from ancient days. There's a lot that this verse tells us. This verse has got to be and only can be a messianic prophecy. There's too much in here that says otherwise. First of all, it's very specific. This person's born not only in Bethlehem, but in Bethlehem Ephratah, it's just this region here, this among this small group of people within Judah. You're going to become a ruler in Israel, this person, And then it says whose goings forth are from old, from ancient days. We'll get to this also later. In common thought in rabbinical Judaism today, the Messiah will be a man that comes and rises up to become the Messiah, right? We saw that with Schneerson in the 90s when Rabbi Schneerson came up and they started proclaiming him Messiah. He was born as a normal person, and they think that. But we know, according to Scripture and according to prophecy, there is a divine component to the Messiah. There is a component where he just is not born, lives, and dies. There is something more there. And it says his coming forth is from old, from ancient days. This is another clue that it's messianic. Anyway, we move on here. There's an interesting commentary that was done hundreds, even thousands of years ago in one of the Targums. Now, the Targums are rabbinical or rabbi writings or commentary writings. It's a collection of them. All of the Torah and the prophets. So it's commentaries on the Torah and the prophets. And they're very old, and they're written in Aramaic. And the whole idea was, even back at the time of Yeshua, you would read the scrolls in the synagogue in Hebrew, and then you would read the Targums in Aramaic so as not to give the commentaries as much weight as the true text. That's why they were written in Aramaic. And Targum Yonatan is one of the ones, and it's a couple of different books it covers, but it covers Micah chapter 5, verse 2. And in the commentary, in the Targum on this scripture, it uses an Aramaic word for Messiah when it translates the verse. So we've known for a long time in Judaism this passage was messianic. Okay. Beit Lechem. What does it mean? It means house of bread. Another clue for us is we know Yeshua is referred in the Bible as the bread of life, right? It says that in the book of John a lot. He comes from the house of bread. And bread has all this kind of symbolism, whether it's unleavened bread during Passover time or regular bread. He is the bread of life. King David was also from Beit Lechem, furthering this connection to the Messiah. Because as we know, Son of David is a messianic title we talked about. So all of these things are coming together here when the scripture is referenced. The people would have known this. You know, many times back then, most of the people would have at least had some understanding of Torah. They would have heard it read every week in the synagogue, certainly. And when they would hear a passage, they would hear something, it would translate in their minds to an even bigger passage. And really what this is telling people as they read this one little scripture verse to Herod was, this is Messiah that this is talking about. Now going back to where we started off, Matthew 2:1, I'm going to read it again. Now after Yeshua was born in Beit Lechem in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. So now we need to talk about the wise men. Who were the wise men? They're called the Magi, right? Everybody's heard of the Magi. You've seen all the things at Christmas time with the three Magi. We don't know if there was three, less than three, more than three. But there was wise men that came. Now, Magi is a term that can be understood to mean magician, astrologer, or wise men. Okay? These are titles for Magi. This would assume, in popular opinion, with all the stories that we see and with a lot of the commentaries that are written, there is a basic assumption that the Magi were Gentiles that came to go worship the king. Now, I'm not going to say for sure that we know that they were Jewish or not, but there's a lot of things that point towards them being Jewish, and I'm going to just give you a few. So, first of all, I'm going to give you a quote. This is a quote from a professor of religion at Vanderbilt University. Her name is Amy Jill Levine. She's Jewish. She has a lot to say and written a lot of books about Yeshua. And the really interesting thing is she's not a believer in Yeshua. She's a traditional Jew, right? Or she's an observant Jew, but she's not a believer. But she has some very good writings about Yeshua, which I think we need to listen to. And I've actually heard her speak before. She's very good. She's very knowledgeable. She casts Yeshua in a positive light. But listen to this quote that she puts in about the Magi in one of her commentaries. She says this: Matthew's second chapter has been read as a foreshadow of the passion, you know, the passion, in which evil Jews persecute the righteous while good Gentiles seek their well-being. This is sort of the beginning of the mindset when you start thinking and reading about these pagan Gentiles got it, but the Jewish people didn't, right? This is a way that people read the New Testament many times, and it is anti-Semitic. I'm not saying they weren't Gentile, but I'm saying that this focus and this emphasis on them as only Gentiles can contribute to an anti-Judaic mindset. And I think that's what's gone on a lot in the last 2,000 years. So I think her comment is, even if it's not spot on, it's certainly something to think about. So anyway, that was her perspective. Well, what do we know about the Magi? So let's dig a little deeper. They were from the East, right? Everybody thinks, oh, that must be the Orient. That must be like Asia or something. East of Jerusalem, there was a large, massive even, Jewish presence. And it was centered around, in many places, but the massive Jewish presence to the east was in a place called Babylon. Babylon. Now, Babylon was a pagan nation. However, we know that the Jewish people, the southern kingdom, was exiled to Babylon about 600 years before this. And then they started coming back after that. They came back under Ezra and Nehemiah. Remember all those writings? They started developing the synagogue concept, and they came back and they restored the temple. And so, but here's the thing. Not all the refugees came back. Many of them stayed in Babylon. Babylon was considered to be and was for hundreds and hundreds of years later a major center of Jewish learning. So much so that the Babylonian Talmud was written there. There's two Talmuds, one written in Israel and one written in Babylon. We basically reference and read all the time. The Babylonian one is more complete. So really, the idea that these people were coming from the Orient, they could have easily been coming from Babylon because there was vibrant Jewish life there. It was a center of Jewish learning, and there were scholars there. Now, they would be studying the scriptures in Babylon, and they would be studying the prophecies about the Messiah in Babylon. So it's entirely possible that the Magi were really Jewish sages living in the region of Babylon in exile. Just as we're here in the diaspora today, they were in the diaspora then. A few other indicators I'm going to give you, and they're tied to scriptures. Turn with me to Numbers chapter 24, verse 17. Now, first of all, they saw and followed a star. You've heard all about that, right? In the Christmas carols, I'm sure. They saw and followed a star. Now, there's hundreds of stars in the sky. What star were they following? Must have been pretty special, because that star led them straight to Yeshua, and they kind of knew that, right? Numbers chapter 24, 17. The context of this verse, this is a prophetic thing in the Torah. The context of this verse is these are words of Balaam. Remember Balaam? He was this pagan sorcerer. He was hired. He was a hired gun by the king of Moab to go and curse Israel. He couldn't do it. He ended up blessing Israel. He was having conversations with the Lord. You know, there's the whole donkey episode. You know the whole story. We've gone through it. But the thing about it is, Balaam is prophesying here. He does a lot of things in his four oracles. One of the oracles is where we get the Matovu liturgy that's sung at synagogues as you sing the Matovu every week as you come into the doors of the synagogue. Those are the words of Balaam. We also see the words of Balaam's here in this prophecy, and it's the fourth oracle, Numbers 24:17. He says this, "I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star shall come out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel, and it shall crush the forehead of Moab and break down all the sons of Sheph." This verse is known to be a messianic verse, talking about the Messiah. Some messianic Jewish commentaries that I have read say that this star is nothing other than the Shekhinah, the divine presence of God. Where do we see the Shekhinah? We see that in the Holy of Holies. Remember when the children of Israel were in the wilderness and they were going those 40 years, God was with them. But he was with them in a very palpable way, because there, that was the place in the Holy of Holies, in the tent where you had the tabernacle, you had the most holy place, the inner court, and that's the place where the ark was. High priest would go in there, and God would come down, the presence of God would come down, and that is called in rabbinic literature, as the Shekhinah, God's divine presence. So The thought processes here from commentators is that star was God's divine presence, the Shekhinah itself. Now, the wise men were following the star, very well could have been following that star prophesied back in the Torah, but here's another clue. How did they know to look for the star at that point? It could have been 100 years before that. It could have been 300 years after that. How did they know to look up and start waiting and looking for this particular star then? We get another clue from Scripture, and it's also in the Tanakh. This is in the book of Daniel. Go to Daniel chapter 9. In Daniel chapter 9, there's a lot of messianic prophecy. We know that. I quoted from it last week, where the conquering king, Yeshua, when he comes back, he'll be the conquering king, Messiah ben David. But there's an interesting passage here that gives us a timeline about Messiah, when the Messiah is supposed to first come. And Daniel 9, 25 and 26 say this: "Now therefore, and understand that from the going out of the word to restore and build Jerusalem," which is when they came back, exiles, "unto the coming of the anointed one, a prince, there shall be 7 weeks. Then for 62 weeks it shall be built again with squares and a moat, but in a troubled time. And after the 62 weeks, an anointed one shall be cut off and shall have nothing. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and its sanctuary. Its end shall come with a flood, and to the end there shall be war. Desolations are decreed." A couple of things we need to key in on this. It's a messianic prophecy talking about Messiah, and it's kind of a split thing. And this happens a lot with prophecies. It's talking about the first and second comings here. But 25 really kind of hits in on a few things. It shall be built at the end of 25 after 62 weeks with squares and a moat, but in a troubled time. We know that it was a difficult time to rebuild the temple. The time of Nehemiah, if you read the book of Nehemiah, they were having all sorts of trouble by the peoples around them. It was rebuilt, the temple was rebuilt, and then there's 62 weeks, and then an anointed one is cut off. This is a very specific timeline, and if you were to do the math, you would find out that it gives the exact date to when Yeshua dies, when the anointed one is cut off. Now, the word anointed one in Hebrew is, of course, Mashiach. That's the actual word. Mashiach means anointed one. Now, they would have known by looking at this prophecy, if they were truly scholars of the word, they would have known that Yeshua is going to die at a certain point in time. It happened to be whatever it is, 28, I think it was, AD. Then they would have known that sometime before that, 30, 40 years, whenever it was, Messiah was to be born, right? So they knew approximately when to start looking for Messiah. And they were looking, and they were seeking, and they were waiting, and then this star appears, and they know. And they drop everything, and they go chase, follow the star. Okay, so there's all these clues from Scripture. They didn't have to guess. They didn't have to wonder, could this be the star? Could this? They were looking at Scripture upon Scripture. They were cross-referencing Scripture. You know, this is what we should be doing in our lives. We shouldn't just take one Scripture verse, take it out of context, and make a denomination or a ruling about how God is based on that one thing. They were taking the Numbers 24 Scripture. They were taking the Daniel 9 Scripture. They were taking all that they knew about the prophecies of Messiah, and it was all coming together for them. They were seeking the Scriptures. This is the whole point. They were reading their Bibles, the Tanakh, the Hebrew Bible. So, and that's the first point today in the message. The Bible is our source for knowing God. Amen. It's not, well, I think it could be this, because that makes sense. There's a lot of stuff that doesn't make sense in the Tanakh to me, but that's me. So I've got to go on face value. I've got to go on faith. They had to correlate all these scriptures, and it all comes together. The Bible and the Bible alone is your and I's source for knowing God. They would have never known God. They would have never understood any of this if they had not sought the scriptures. We study the Bible, yes, to learn prophecy. Prophecy is important, but it's not all of the Bible. We study also to learn how to live our lives before the Holy One of Israel. We want to know God. We need to know God, and we need to know what He says. And the only way to know all that is to go and search His Word, to study His Word. And I can't stress that enough. Reading it, studying it, applying it to our lives, searching for God as the wise men did. Let's be wise like the wise men, right? Matthew chapter 2, verse 2. Let's continue on with the text. So they come, and then it says, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? They go before Herod. They say, where is he who's been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. And there's just so much even in that verse right there. This is the Magi talking. We already discussed the star. We already discussed how they're searching and seeking the scripture to know and understand what's going on. I want to talk about a few things here. Number one, the phrase, the king of the Jews. This is another one of those phrases that can be interpreted as kind of an anti-Semitic thing, or, well, they must have been Gentiles because they say, well, where is this Jew king? You know, where is this Jewish king? And that's really not what the translation says. David Stern pointed out that it really should say the king of the Judeans, which is the region where Messiah was supposed to be born. So they could have very well been Jewish people saying, where is the one who is to be crowned king of the Judeans from the Judean region, the region where Messiah would be born? And next they say, where is he so that we may worship him? Now that's really interesting, because we know if they were Jewish sages, they would have known Deuteronomy 6:4 says God is one, right? This is the thing for our people. This is the stumbling block to Yeshua about how God is one. So how can it be a Father and a Son and the Holy Spirit? We don't even have time to get into that. All I'm going to say about this is the word one in Deuteronomy 6:4 is a plural one. If God wanted to say singular one, he would have used a different Hebrew word. Number two, even in early Jewish thought, there wasn't a way to limit God and say, well, he's just this one single thing right here that never is anything else. There was what they call in Judaism facets of God. It's like looking at things from a different angle. When you look at somebody from a different angle, you kind of see different, almost a different person in a way, but it's the same person. When we see God as a Father, we see him at one facet. When we see God as a Son, we see him in another facet. And as the Ruach, that's how he's chosen to reveal himself to us. But don't take the New Testament's word for it. Go back to Genesis 1:1. And Genesis 1:1 to 3 shows us the Spirit of God hovering over the waters, the Word of God, who John 1 says then becomes flesh, and that's Yeshua, the Son, and we see God the Father creating with those facets. So we know that in Judaism, it always has not been just a singular one, and that is it. That was obviously a reaction to Yeshua over the years. But we've got to understand Scripture as it's meant to be understood. So anyway, God is one. Yeshua could certainly come, and they could certainly worship this facet of God, the one true God, this facet of God. So it's entirely possible. Okay, and then we have here the sages, the wise men, seeking the Messiah. They come and they say, where is he? We've searched for him. We want to see him so they may worship him. You don't worship anything besides God, right? We know this. We know this, and they knew this too. Now, they would have come from Babylon. How did the Jewish people get to Babylon? They got to Babylon because of sin, because they departed from God, because they were following the ways of, you know, the fool. They created all these idols, and they were taken out of the land. We know that. They're in exile in Babylon. The prophet Jeremiah is ministering to the exiles, and there was a lot of hopelessness, you know, in a lot of ways. They would sit by the waters of Babylon, as that psalm says, and cry and weep for Zion, for Jerusalem, for Israel. But also there was words of hope and indication that this wasn't a final cast out. This wasn't a final exile. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13 says this. And this was written originally to the exiles in Babylon. We always have to understand original context of what scriptures were written in, and then pull it out and you can apply it to today. But you got to first understand the original context. It was to the exiles in Babylon, and here's what it said. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. So all those exiles in Babylon thinking that all hope was lost, God has thrown us out, they had hope because they knew that if they sought him, they would find him. The wise men were seeking him, and guess what? They found him. Point number two for us this morning, each of us must seek the Lord. Be like the wise men, right? Seek the Lord while he may be found. They were seeking, they were searching, They knew it wasn't a permanent exile in Babylon. They knew God was doing a new thing, and he was going to bring forth this Mashiach. But each of us must be like that and seek out the Lord. Now look, the journey from Babylon to Israel was not just like a five-mile stretch like Beit Lechem to Jerusalem. It was a long and arduous journey, especially when they didn't have automobiles, right, and GPS. I get lost going to the grocery store. How am I going to find my way from Babylon to Israel? It was a tough, long journey. But you know what? It would have been easy for them to give up. It would have been easy for them to say, okay, we saw the star, good enough to know. Let's just go back to our comfortable life here. No, they pressed on. They pushed through it. They gave up all that they had to go. I don't know how long it took, but it took a while. They had to disrupt all of their life when God came calling. They were going and seeking after him. And you and I need to do that. Sometimes God disrupts our normal life, and we have to stop, and we have to search after God. We have to follow after him. Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 and 8. There's a lot of scriptures that talk about seeking the Lord. Seeking him and you will find him, like that scripture in Jeremiah. Well, Matthew 7, 7 and 8 says this: ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened. That is hope right there. That is encouraging for us. It was encouraging to them back then when they read that scripture in Jeremiah, when they heard that scripture, and it's encouraging for us today with that scripture in Matthew. Now let's go back on to our text, Matthew chapter 2, verse 3. When Herod heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. Before we get to why he was troubled, let's figure out who he is. Who was Herod? He was called Herod the Great. He ruled over the region of Judea, as we said before. He died in about 4 BCE. Now, Herod was not great in the eyes of God or in the eyes of the people. He did some nice things. He was the one who enlarged and renovated the Second Temple. He made it grand and glorious. But he did a whole lot of bad things. He was an evil, vindictive, vicious man. And there is a lot of indication. We have a lot of things from Josephus and others that tell us how bad this Herod the Great really was. Now, the Bible tells us Herod was troubled when he heard that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. Why was he troubled? Wasn't that an awesome thing? Wow, finally the Messiah is here. I'm the king of this region. All the people are waiting for the Messiah. Great, let's go get a caravan. Let's go meet him there, you know. He doesn't say that. Why was he troubled? Because Herod was, first of all, he was crazy. Absolutely crazy. He was totally paranoid about losing his power. We know this. It's not just conjecture. We know that he had all of his rivals killed. We had some of the members of his wife's family he killed because they were a threat. And he had some of his 15 children killed because they were a threat. This child that was born in Beit Lechem was a threat to Herod and his power. You know, the saying goes, absolute power corrupts absolutely. Herod was absolutely corrupt. He wasn't even thinking straight. He had power, but he had acquired it, and he was full of that pride and that power and that self. A couple of scriptures about that. Psalm 10, verse 4. Go to the Psalm, Psalm 10, verse 4. You know, the Bible talks a lot about not being full, not having that kind of pride, because it has disastrous consequences. But this is the mentality of people that are so far gone, like Pharaoh, like Herod. Psalm 10, verse 4. In the pride of his face, the wicked does not seek him, does not seek God. All his thoughts are, there is no God. You know what Herod thought? I'm God. You know, I'm the man. Forget about this. We're going to get rid of this. We'll see next week the terrible things he does to try to snuff out what God is doing. But he wasn't successful, obviously. Proverbs 18:12, talking about pride. Before destruction, a man's heart is haughty, but humility comes before honor. For all of Herod's scheming and trying to thwart what God was doing, he ends up dying not too soon after. And all of that was gone for him. Point number three, and this is a key point, self and pride push us not towards God, but away from God. you can push yourself away from God to a point where you're not even thinking clearly. You could see prophetic scriptures, and you could say, nah, I'm just going to do what I'm going to do. This is what Herod did. Self and pride push us away from God. Now, in the Garden of Eden, the break with man and God originally came over the notion that man could be like God. And that notion is, in one word, pride. They could do it without God's sovereignty over them. They could be like God, not under God. This elevation of self, this elevation of pride, what did it do? Produced a separation. And they pushed themselves away from God, and then God sent them out. But they were the ones that first do it. Make no mistake. God didn't just say, I'm done with you, get out. They pushed themselves away from God first, because self and pride push us away from God. We have to be very careful in our lives that we don't separate ourselves from the Word of God, but more importantly, from God Himself. Because when we get ourselves involved too much and the pride too much, we could start drifting away from God of our own doing. We have to be very careful about that. Okay, Matthew chapter 2. Let's keep going through the rest of the text. Verses 8 and 9. And Herod says this. And he said to them in Bethlehem, saying, go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word that I too may go and worship him. After listening to the king, they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. Okay, so let's go quickly through these verses throughout the rest of the passage. Herod was obviously trying to trick the wise men. He had no intention of going and worshiping the child. He was going to go and kill the child, right? Because we know he was troubled. So what do the wise men do? Well, first they go and they find Yeshua. They find him, they go into the house, they worship him. And by the way, he was not a baby. He was like 2 years old at this point. That's a whole other discussion. We'll get to that. They find Yeshua. They go to the house, not the manger or the sukkah, right? He's in the house. They worship him and they give him gifts. Now you could say, oh, that's the gifts that we see in the little nativity scenes, and isn't that cute? Well, there's always things behind it, and this is also a messianic significance. Turn with me. First of all, go to Matthew 2:11. What were the gifts? And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. And then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. I think we all know that by heart, right? But did you know what the significance of those three gifts are? Gold is a symbol of kingship. Frankincense is a symbol of deity. Myrrh is a symbol of death and sacrifice. In those three gifts, this is so prophetic that they're talking about how Yeshua is going to be king, he's going to be God, and he's also going to die for the sins of the people, death and sacrifice. Now, turn with me to Psalm 76, verse 1. There's some scriptures, there's actually a lot of scriptures that talk about gifts in relation to messianic significance or prophecy. One of them is Psalm 76, 11, and it says this, make your vows to the Lord your God and perform them, to let all around bring him gifts to him who is to be feared. They were doing what the scripture outlined. There's one more thing in this passage, verse 12 of Matthew 2. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, like he told them to, they departed to their own country by another way. Now that is also very key. Herod tells them, and he had a lot of power and a lot of sway. He was a very foreboding man, we know. He was a very influential man and king, and very important and powerful. Now, the sages, though, they were wise and godly. They know not to listen to Herod. Something would have told them. It wasn't just good intuition. It was the Lord. He came to them in a dream, and being warned, they followed God. Now, what they could have said was, boy, did you get that dream too? Yeah, we must have ate something bad last night because that was a weird dream. Well, forget about that. Herod told us to go to him. No, they said, this is God. This is what we need to do. We're not going to listen to man, no matter who man is. We're going to listen to God because they were godly. Matthew chapter 10, verse 28. This is a key scripture here about this. And do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Herod could have very easily killed their bodies. Right? He could have found them and done away with them. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both the soul and body in hell. Now, obviously, that scripture wasn't there for them at the time, but it captures the essence of it quite nicely. They didn't fear Herod, a man. They feared the Lord. The Lord spoke to them in a dream, and they listened and responded. It's, you know, God is speaking to us all the time. Are we listening, and are we responding? Point number four, the last point today. We must be sensitive to the Lord's prompting. We want the earthquakes. We want the lightning bolts. God, what do I do? Boom, do this. Oh, that was easy. Great. Thank you for that. He doesn't give us the lightning bolts in the just like the passage in 1 Kings when Elijah's looking for God. He doesn't come in the earthquake. He doesn't come in the fire. He comes in the whisper. You and I have got to be dialed into God like the wise men were to be sensitive to the Lord's prompting. We need to be sensitive to the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. The wise men didn't listen to Herod. They listened to the Lord. They listened to that still small voice. Are we listening to all of the Herods and all of the loud noises out there that seem to be very convincing and that seem to be very intimidating in our lives? Or are we listening to the prompting of God? Now listen, we need to make sure it's the prompting of God and we didn't eat something the night before, right? Like I said. But make sure it's the prompting of God, and it's the prompting of God. It's the prompting of God, as Yogi Berra said. If it is, it is, right? Quite simply. So this is the key. We have got to be sensitive. God is going to show you something. You're going to say, is that God? What is that? He's going to confirm it because he's in the business of confirming things. Somebody will say something to you. Something will happen. You'll know that it was the Lord. Now, you've got to be sensitive. I've got to be sensitive to that. If not, we're just going to listen to all the Herods and all the voices around us, and we're going to step into a lot of trouble. But the wise men were sensitive to God's prompting, and you and I need to be wise, listening to the prompting of God. We can be either wise like the wise men or foolish like Herod. It's so much easier to be foolish like Herod because the things of the world can take our focus off God in a New York minute. You know what I mean? But God is right there. He's in his word. He's there with the gentle prompting. Are we going to listen like the wise men when God starts speaking? So this passage just tells us so much about getting into the word, correlating scripture upon scripture, being sensitive to God, listening, seeking, moving towards God. We can't hear the prompting of God if we're moving in the opposite direction from him. Your back's going to be to him. Okay? And I don't know about you, but if my back's to somebody, I really can't hear them. I can look at their lips. Also, I have a bit of a hearing problem, but I can look at their lips or I can hear them when I'm focusing on them. But when you got your back turned to somebody, you can't focus on them. Let's not have our backs turned toward the Lord. Let's turn around, do teshuva, and let's march towards the Lord. Let's seek him. Let's strive towards him. Let's build everything upon him and his ways, and he will show us his heart and what to do with our lives. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you because in this passage today, there's a clear choice. We could be wise or foolish. And guess what? We can get blessings or curses. Lord, I just thank you that we as a congregation are moving towards you. May it always be so that we as individuals and families are purposed to move towards you and not away from you. God, speak to us, ground us in scripture, because all sorts of deceiving spirits are out there saying, this way, he's over here, do this, this is God. It's so enticing. It's got all the bells and whistles. It looks pretty, it sounds pretty, but in the end, it is not pretty, and it's a straight ticket, not to heaven, but to hell. We need to understand that the wise way is the way of facing God, moving towards him, reading his word, praying, and listening to his voice. God, I pray that you show people your voice. I pray that you speak to people in small ways and even in big ways today. I pray that people would realize that they've got to focus on you, that they have got to take away and get rid of that self and pride and put in its place your words. May we be filled with your words. May we be filled with your spirit. May we be filled with the light of the world, Yeshua, and may we be lights, not of our own, but of you reflected in us. We thank you, God. We praise you. We give you all the praise, glory, and honor in Yeshua's name. Amen and amen. Let's all stand. We're going to close our service with a blessing. Numbers chapter 6. May you be blessed today. Don't forget, we have Oneg today. We have Torah for today. Stay in fellowship. Stay and dig into the word with us more today as we go through Parsha Noach. And there's a lot to cover, as Rabbi Allen said. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of our Messiah, Yeshua, the Prince of Peace. Yevrechecha Adonai v'yishmarecha. Yer Adonai panav alecha v'chunecha. Yesa Adonai panav alecha v'yasim lecha. Shalom. B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach. Sar Shalom. Amen and Amen. Shabbat Shalom, everyone. God bless. Have a wonderful week in the Lord.